So I would like to introduce to you my kindred spirit, Wendy Duke.
Can you hear me? Okay. I'm actually relieved. My family is going to be relieved because I just met Shimin face to face last night, actually, at the airport. And my family was concerned that because I had met Shimin online, basically, that I was being lured into a human trafficking ring, which is a commentary that we watch too many crime shows. I am from the great state of South Carolina, and I know there are some Carolina girls here tonight, and so let's just get it out there. I have an accent. If that bothers you, I don't know how to help with that. I just do. It's just who I am. And contrary to what you might know of South Carolina, we do not all live on plantations or on little shacks on the beach. We don't all drive pickup trucks or hunt alligators or anything like that. You might be surprised we actually have cities in South Carolina. I live in kind of a smallish city in the upstate, which is just really the perfect place because we're close to the beach and close to the mountains. And I love my city. I grew up pretty close to there. I grew up in a home that was my father had been raised in a Christian home. My mother had not. My mother came from a broken home and married my dad and always felt like the black sheep of the family. My mom, I'm just so proud to be her daughter. And I wasn't even planning to say this tonight, but she's just overcome so much. She has been courageous, and even at an age that she would not let me say in public, she is still learning new things, and she's still trying to put off old habits and become a better version of herself, and I'm just so proud of her. She asked me about being here. My sister, Jenny, actually came here with me today, which is a good thing for everybody because Jenny has literally, we got here last night, and she has kept the wheels from falling off. I'll share with you later. I am not a type A personality. I know Jen said she was when she first became a mom, had those tendencies. Shimin is very type A. She's had this schedule down to the second. She's been praying for all of you and planning for all of you. I'm more like a type Q, maybe. I'll share about that later, but I just need you to know that. So I don't know how this is going to go tonight. I've got notes, but sometimes I go off script. So we're just going to trust the Holy Spirit. And just know that I'm really excited to be here because while motherhood was not something that I felt prepared for or still feel prepared for, actually, it's such a privilege, right? It's a privilege for us. And so I'm really privileged to stand before you, and so unqualified. Well, I'll just say that first. So unqualified. I'm still learning. But I'm going to share with you our family story because it has had some not so pretty parts. I actually have a PowerPoint, and I have no idea how this will go. Dave in the back assures me that I can run this, but I'm not so sure. So this is my husband, Scott. We do not look like this normally. There are great photographers out there. If you're a photographer, we love you. We love you. That is a spiritual gift. So, as I said, I grew up in a Christian home for the most part. My mom became actually a believer at the age of 33 and was baptized at 33, which to me, in a small town where I live, where everybody goes to church every Sunday morning, for my mom to walk forward in a church and say, I need to know Jesus and I don't, is tremendously brave to me. And so we constantly were in church, and I loved church. I knew all about Jesus. I knew all about God. I loved stories and the people, especially the women that poured into me during my childhood. But I'm the oldest of three girls, and my daddy, I adore my dad, am a daddy's girl, and my daddy played sports. And so our bonding time was shooting hoops in the front yard. I also grew up in a neighborhood full of boys, and so we played football and forts and all that. And so I was just always a tomboy growing up. And so I played sports in middle school, moved on to high school, and I really, like, my identity really became centered in sports. It was a little unusual. A lot of my friends were cheerleaders, other things. I have some friends here tonight that came from my high school. And I just loved sports. And as I became more involved, more competitive, it really started to become almost an idol in my life. My whole identity was wrapped up in it. And so I got a scholarship to a very liberal women's college in my hometown, very nearby my home, far enough to, you know, have my freedom, live on campus, but still close enough to take laundry home. And so during college, this faith that I'd had growing up in this small town, Southern Baptist Church, that poured into me, I just began to question. I started to hear other ways of thinking and other beliefs, and I just started to really search for truth. What did I believe? What was true? Had I just been taught this my whole life and hadn't really thought it through? My faith was really very shallow. And so during college, I had a couple of bad relationships, and this girl invited me to FCA one night. I met this guy, and that was all she wrote. He was a basketball player. I was a basketball player. This was like written in, you know, in books in heaven somewhere. Had to be. So met Scott. I knew when I first met him that he had something solid in him that I didn't have. His faith was more than just what he said he believed, but he lived it. He's always had a servant's heart and a ministry heart, and knew very early on that he was called to ministry. And he's just a good man through and through. Not perfect, right? He leaves his socks around, things like that, and other things, but good guy. I'm so lucky, and he's just so supportive of me, and I'm just grateful for him. So when we met, we both wanted to be high school basketball coaches, and we wanted to be high school teachers. So we started teaching right out of school. We have a son. I'm going to show you JP. Okay, this is JP. This is not a current picture, but this is one of my favorites because this captures his personality so well. This was not part of the photo plan, the photography plan. This was. The photographer caught this when he was climbing this ladder where the danger authorized personnel only sign happens to be. That's just his personality. Any of you who have boys, you know this is true. And he's a second born. Okay? So this is JP now on a skateboard on a treadmill. This is how we live. This is how we live. But JP was not our first child. He was not our first baby. JP is 13 now. He is as tall as I am, but he was not our first. When we had been married 2 years, we had one miscarriage, and it was sort of a surprise. I didn't even think I wanted children. I wanted to be a college basketball coach. I wanted a career. I was very ambitious, very driven. And so when we had this first miscarriage, it rocked my world. Because I didn't think I wanted to be a mom yet. And then all of a sudden, it just began to grow in me. And then a year later, we had another miscarriage. And a year later, we had another miscarriage. And so by the third miscarriage, although we were both involved in church, I really began to think, I don't know what this is about. I don't know how you go to church and you can be a Christian and this kind of thing happened. We have been praying over this. I started to just really question and doubt my faith. When we had been married 4 years, we were pregnant with this was our fourth pregnancy, and we made it to the 20-week mark. And we went in. Oh, sorry, told you I was going to mess something up. This is me aiming my dart gun at my son that my friend caught on camera. This is my son with my dog who is emotionally disturbed and had a panic attack outside of the groomers and just went limp. Just, I'm not moving from here. And we then he took off into the street. Okay, so that's our other job. This is our first ultrasound of our first baby at 20 weeks. And we were so thrilled because we thought we'd made it past, you know, we were in a safe place, a safe point. And we went in and the ultrasound technician let us know, baby is a girl. We're having a daughter. And I could see it, you know, on my husband's face. You know, they say they want boys, and then they hear they have a girl and they just melt, you know? And within the first few minutes, I could tell that that there was something. She was not telling us everything. And I finally said, is there something else we need to know? And she started to cry. And she said, baby only has one leg. And you, like Jen said, you think you have kind of these plans, you know, and you're gonna, you know what your kid's gonna do and the future they're gonna have. And you set all these things in motion and you just think you know. And in that moment, everything turned upside down. What do you mean she only has one leg? What do you even do with that information? Within the next few minutes, a doctor came in, took us into his office, and he began to explain to us how when there's a birth defect, she had almost no leg on the left side. And when there are birth defects like hers, then the likelihood of having multiple birth defects greatly increased. That, you know, she could have a chromosomal disorder, all of the things that could, these horrible things that could be wrong with her. And he began to explain to her, to us, very quickly, why we should explore all of our options. And he said to us, you're young, you can start over. I think your best option is just to terminate. And my husband, because I was in this very fragile place, and ladies, we are all mothers here, but there are so many of us who have heard words like this, your best option is to abort. So many of us who struggle with grief over this and regret and guilt and shame, so many who have been in similar situations. And that is such a fragile place. And my husband stood up and said, sir, there is no way we're taking the life of our child. Whatever God hands us, we'll deal with. But this is not an option for us. And we got up and we left. And the next week we came back for an amniocentesis. And in that amniocentesis, if any of you have had this, he put the needle in and he said, you know, the baby's move away from the needle. So I don't want you to worry, but we're gonna have it on the screen so you can see she's fine. He still was trying to encourage us to not continue this pregnancy. And so when he put the needle in, I'm freaking out for one thing, but we're watching on the screen. And she instinctively begins to move away from the needle. And he's talking and he's kind of telling, you know, just very dry, talking through stuff. And then all of a sudden, she reaches up and she grabs on to the shaft of that needle. And he stammered and choked on his words. And he said, I have never seen that happen in all of my life. And we knew he had a fighter. And there was something about that that just gave me hope and gave me courage. And so we went through the rest of that pregnancy, but I have to tell you, I was struggling with God. I did not want to pray. I did not want to think about what kind of a God could allow something like this to happen. We talked through all of the things. Okay, so this is where we are. So what can she do? We began to name all the things she would be able to do. And so when it came time for our Savannah, we had named her Savannah by this point, to be born. She was born in September, and she was indeed born without a left leg. And they couldn't figure out what the problem was, what caused it. There was a large kind of wound on the back where her leg would have been. And so within a week, we had a biopsy, and the doctor said, I don't think, you know, this is not going to be malignant, but we just need to check it in just in case. Came back in a few hours later, and he said, I am so sorry to tell you this, but it's cancer. It's malignant, and we need to start chemo immediately. And I was holding my 6-day-old baby, And I was sitting in a rocking chair, and our family was there. And I just yelled out at the top of my lungs, "Where is God? Where is God?" And I know that maybe sitting in this room, some of you have, and maybe are, thinking the same thing. You're in the middle of your marriage unraveling, or in a health crisis with your own family. You're in the middle of a financial meltdown in your home. Things just have not turned out the way you thought, and you are wondering, where is God in the middle of this? We started chemo at about 10 days old. She was 10 days old when we started. We went through 3 months, and the chemo didn't work. We had surgery at 5 months, thought they got all the cancer out. A few months later, it grew back larger than it was. And so at 13 months old, we were at Cincinnati Children's Hospital, and we were getting ready to go into the next day a major surgery that was going to be about 12 hours. And I was going to have to hand over one more time my tiny little girl, who at this point can say some words. We're thinking through this, we're preparing. It's about 9 o'clock one night, and this last doctor comes in and he sits down, which you never want to happen if you're in the hospital room. And he said, "I want to make sure that you understand the risk. The tumor has grown into her spine now. We just got the scan back. And when we take it out, there's a high likelihood that she'll be paralyzed." And I just stood up and I walked out of the room. The only way I know to describe it is that I had just come to the end of myself. I had been this very self-reliant, ambitious, capable, independent woman. That's who I thought I was. And the rug had just been ripped underneath me for the last time, and I just didn't want to play anymore. So I stood at the end of this hallway, and it was dark, and I'm looking out over the parking lot. And for the first time in my life, I just dropped down on my knees. I'd heard about God my whole life. During this time, people had come alongside us, had prayed for us, had served us in so many ways. The church really became the hands and feet of Jesus and had spent time with us and cut our yard and helped clean our home and brought meals and all of these things that, as I'm searching for who God is, all these people sort of lined up like lights on a runway, pointing, "Come this way. Come this way." And so I was at the end of that runway, and I dropped to my knees and I said, "God, I need you. If you're true, I need you. I don't care what you have to do with me, what you want to do with our family. We just need you to come through." And I sat there for a long time. And I want to tell you that in those moments, it wasn't like some cheesy, you know, Kirk Cameron movie, although I love his movies. I love him. So not planned. I love his movies, I really do. It wasn't like a melodramatic moment, but it felt like all of a sudden, like chains fell off. Like this heaviness and this the weight of trying to be strong and trying to carry everything myself and trying to do everything myself, it just began to fall off, and it was the freest I'd ever felt. And I don't know how long I sat there, but I got up finally and I went down back to the room, and we prepared all night. And the next morning we had to hand our daughter to an OR nurse. And I knew all the stories about God. And I knew how he had done the same thing, and he had handed over his son for my good. We sat in the waiting room all day long, 13 hours, doctors in and out, people, families in and out. We were the last ones in the waiting room. And the doctor finally came out, and he said, "I believe you must be a family of faith, because we got it. We got it all." And that was 14 years, and we've been cancer-free for 14 years now. Savannah is now 15, which is a whole struggle on its own. That is in the NICU. This is when she, her first day of chemo. This is her high school swim team. And you should hear the audible gasp when she gets up on that diving board right there. Like this lady down here, she's about to have a meltdown. She's about to have a nervous breakdown. It thrills me every time. This is Savannah on just a little local magazine that covered something that I'm going to tell you about, because there was this sense for me as I really committed my life to God for the first time. I began to read scripture with this whole different light. Like I began to just hunger for God's word. Show me who you are. Teach me who you are. I believe you. And I began to understand that even if he had not come through that day, he would have still been God. He would have still been exactly the same God that he is every other day. Even if that doctor had come in and given us the worst news we could have possibly gotten. And some of you have been exactly there. As I began to read the scripture, this one passage started to just feel like this is my story. And it was a story in John 11 of the resurrection of Lazarus. And the part in the very beginning, the first few chapters, where his sisters Mary and Martha, they're sending word to Jesus. Jesus, Lazarus is sick. We need you to come. We need you to come now. And Jesus says they're going to wait. They're going to stay right where they are. And he says, I'm glad that this has happened so that you can see God's glory. Now, I'm thinking about what Mary and Martha must be thinking. They're waiting on him. They're waiting on him to show up. He is not showing up. He's doing something else. And Jesus says again to his disciples, it is for your benefit that we're waiting so that you can see God's glory. And then he comes finally after 3 days, and he comes and Lazarus is already dead. They have already buried him. He's been in the grave. And Mary and Martha first comes out and says, if you'd been here, this wouldn't have happened, but I still believe that if you say so, you can heal him. And then Mary comes out later, and she says, if you had been here, if you had just shown up when we asked you to. And then Jesus wept, because he mourns when we mourn, and he grieves when we grieve, and his heart breaks at the same time that ours does, even when he's waiting for the right time. And then he says some of the most powerful words ever spoken. He says, move away the stone, and then he says, Lazarus, come forth. Lazarus, come forth. And he calls him out of that darkness into the light. And he resurrects him. And I felt like I was Lazarus. At first, when I first began seeking God and following him, I felt like I'm Lazarus. And then, as my relationship with the Lord has deepened, there's this part in the very last thing he says in that passage. He says to the people, he says, take off the grave clothes and let him go. And I have found that to be so profound, that he didn't just call him out of the grave, but he started taking off all that old, dead, rotting, old stuff he had been wearing before. And I began to see a lot of my own habits, ways of thinking, the ways I just depended on myself instead of depending on God, the way I was treating my husband. And I just started praying, God, I need you to start taking these off. I don't know how to do this. And the very next story in the Bible, in John 12, is Mary. And she goes before this room full of men, sitting at tables just like this, and Jesus is there. And this is right after she's, or the story right after she's raised his brother. And she goes to Jesus and she pours out this expensive jar of perfume. And the other disciples start complaining, what a waste. That could have been used for the poor. And Jesus says, leave her alone. She's done a beautiful thing. She did what she could. And then I thought, I'm Mary. And I've seen God do the impossible. And so what can we do? And so it's just been that process of trying to figure out, what can we do for Jesus? What can we do to repay him for what he's done in our lives? Not just for saving our daughter, but for saving us, for bringing us out of the grave. But also, what do you need to take off? What is old and dead and rotting on me that you need to take off so that I look more like you? And so it's been that process. For the last 15 years, that's been this process between me and Jesus, is asking him to change me and to take off the things I don't need to let me go. And also to figure out what it is that we can do. So here's kind of what happened after that. Our son JP was born 2.5 years later. So Savannah has a little brother. Within a few weeks, we had known for a while, we had heard the statistics in the world about the number of people that not only did not believe in Jesus, but had never heard of him, had never heard his name before, did not have Christian radio, did not have women's conferences, did not have Christians in their cities of 1 million people, did not know that Jesus existed, did not know. And we just became burdened with that. And we thought, what can we do? What can we do? We're both still coaching. I had just decided when JP was born that I felt like God was unraveling some things in me. He was taking off that ambitious stuff I'd been carrying around and making me be a stay-at-home mom. That's right. That's right. But he changed my heart about that, because if you had known me 5 years earlier, there was no way. There was no way. And so God was changing this in my heart. So we feel like we've somehow been called to missions. What can we do to tell people how good Jesus is? What can we do to let them know? And at the same time, I'm feeling the call to stay home. So my husband, we're wrestling with this, and my husband knows for sure. He comes back one day and he says, I know that we're called to missions. And I was like, yes, I'm with you. And he said, and I think it's in sports. I think we're just supposed to use our sports. And I'm not sure what that's going to look like yet, but we know, this is the thing we know how to do. This is what we can do. And I was like, okay, I'm down with that. If we can coach and play and all this kind of, yes. And he said, so I've decided I'm going to go to my principal tomorrow and let him know that I'm not coming back next year. And I said, you're going to what? Have you lost your mind? And I started to wrestle with, okay, benefits, paycheck. I just gave up my job. How are we going to do this? And so God has, it has been the craziest, wildest ride. And there's no way I can tell you the whole story, but God took us both out of secular, whatever is secular in ministry. It's all ministry if we're doing it for God. But he took us, and he's provided for us. We never missed a mortgage payment. We can pay doctor's bills, but he's provided for us by bringing people alongside of us. And so full-time now, we go to, we started a nonprofit sports development company, and we go to countries in the world that don't allow missionaries. So they're places that are very close to Christianity, and so we go in and we work with their sports teams, with their national foundations. We work with training their players. We take coaches. We take players, the whole deal, whatever we can do to get into that country, and then we build relationships. We've been working in some of these countries that would not even allow Americans in. God's opened the door because sports, everybody wants to be good at sports, right? That's the world idol. And so we've taken that and we're just doing what we can. And it's not any better or more important than any of the other things that people are doing in ministry. It's just the thing we know how to do. And God's just been so good and so faithful in that. And so we traveled to some kind of scary places. And it took me a while to come on board with Scott because he travels a lot more than I do. And so there are times when I'm at home, and he's doing ministry, and then I'm at home cleaning up SpaghettiOs or whatever off the floor. So some of the places, we also do prison ministry. We go into prisons, which people tell us we are insane to do that, but we go into prisons, and you would not believe men's prisons and women's prisons. We take women's teams, softball players and volleyball players into these prisons, and we play, and it breaks down these walls, and then we just talk with them. We just share our stories, and they share their stories, and the heartbreak of women who just made one bad decision, and they haven't seen their children in 5 years, and almost all of them have children, and my heart breaks. And some of them, they know they just messed up, but some of them, I had the opportunity to share this story, and 40 women came and said, I want to know this Jesus. I want to know this Jesus too. And we're just blown away at the things that God can do if we just do what we can. And all of us have different gifts, right? We're all gifted in different ways. None is more important than the other. You have different skill sets than I do. You have different circles of influence than I do. And so that's one of the things that God's been taking off for me. And I think I'm just going to hit 3 points that I think for women especially are hard for us to let go of. They're grave clothes that we have to be willing to let go of. One of them is control, right? Here is my control issue right now. Savannah just got her license, and nobody tells you about this in MOPS. Nobody in the nursery ever told me about this. Nobody told me I needed like blood pressure medicine for this experience in life, this season in life. And so there's this, I think for us as moms, just exactly what Jen said earlier, that we had this thing about control. We were going to control. We're going to make sure our kids are happy and safe and nothing bad happens. We're going to manage everything they do. They don't even have to make decisions because we're just going to make them for them. And they become college students who can't decide what to major in or what class to take or how to make any decisions because they've been made for them their whole lives. And this idea of control that we've got to make, that we've got to administrate everything, and sometimes kids just need a safe place to land. They just need home to be a soft, safe place instead of scooting off to the next activity and this activity and running around like crazy. And statistically, 40% of college freshmen enter school on anxiety medicine. 40% of incoming freshmen. There is much stress in our children's lives. And that controlling and trying to put them in everything and make sure that they are going to be Major League Baseball players because we've gotten them in the right league at 4 years old, it's craziness. Let me tell you, if they're good at sports, they're going to make it. Can I just tell you that as a sports person? If that's their gift, if that's God's plan for them, they're going to do it. You can equip them, but listen, it's hard, and you don't have to compete with everybody else's kid. Does yours no good? Most of the time when kids start that young, they're a junior in high school and they don't even want to play anymore. It's supposed to be fun. And if it's not fun, let it go. I'm just going to tell you that from a coach's perspective. So here's the thing. There are a few things that we struggle with in this area of control. And it's the things not turning out the way we plan, right? So many in here, you have kids with disabilities or struggles in some other area, learning problems, or your kid's being bullied at school, or all kinds of things that are happening with your kids. They're not achieving what you thought they would, or they're not like you and your husband. Things aren't turning out the way you planned. And so we're trying to manipulate and maneuver things. And that never, it never works out. My son is 13, and he's about my size, and all he wants to do is play basketball. I hate that so much. It's so disappointing. But he loves it. He's played all sports, but this is the one he's landed on. We've tried so hard not to push, because you know if you push, they're not going to want to anymore. So we've had our hands off, and he tried out for his school team this year. I'm going to tell you, how many of you have been through a kid's tryouts? Nobody told me about this either. So the swim team, Savannah didn't have to try out for swim team because, you know, they're not as many kids, but there were 80 kids trying out for 12 spots on the 7th grade basketball team at our public school. 80 spots. I mean, I'm sweating. I'm texting teacher friends. Did you hear anything? Have you heard anything? So we get the word that he's not made the team and that it might not have been fair. I mean, Mama Bear starts crawling out of me. I'm going to call the principal. I'm going to call the athletic director. And then I have to stop. Mostly because my husband said so, but I have to stop. He said, just wait. Let's just wait. So I just had to pray. Like, pray over this. It was all I could think about. Because he was trying to act cool about it, but I could tell he's disappointed, and you don't want that to happen to your kids. So I'm trying to take my hands off. So we start this little league. We decide we need to get him involved in basketball somewhere. He's got to keep playing if he wants to play next year. So my husband and I couldn't find a league, so we decided we'd coach his team. So we've got these other little kids, these friends of his, and we have this great year. He just blossomed. Like, JP just blossomed. He improved and just, like, found his niche. And we were going to church a few weeks ago, and there was this event, and they were supposed to invite somebody to it. And he really hit it off with one of these kids on the team. And it was kids that didn't make the other team. And he said, I think I'm going to invite this kid, because I don't know if he knows Jesus yet. And maybe this is why God didn't let me make the basketball team. Kidding me? Out of the mouths of babes sometimes. Sometimes God doesn't show up because he knows something more than we know. Sometimes he's waiting for the right moment. One passage that has become such a life verse for me is Isaiah 55:9, and it says, my ways are higher than your ways. Trust me. The other two are this, comparison. I'm not really like most of the women I know. I am a terrible cook. I mean, terrible cook. Let's see if I have these in the right order. This is our whole family. This looks like we've got it together, right? And this is also, again, our emotionally disturbed dog. But this just looks like the all-American family. Okay, this is what it looks like when your mom is a basketball nut. I don't know how to knit or any other of the other things that that women sometimes at my church are doing. I'm not going to the quilting event. I'm not doing it. I don't know how to. I have no domestic abilities. All I can do is stack up mail on the counter there. I don't know how I miss this. This picture that I'm getting ready to show you is during this last snowstorm. You guys had it up here. You were out for like a week of school. My friend Caroline, they were out for like a week. I don't know how you make that up. But we were out for about 3 days, and my husband was in West Africa during this time. So I'm in the house. We're snowed in, and my children are both downstairs with earbuds on. This is a first-person picture. None of my kids are responding because they're listening to iTunes. We have zero toilet paper in the whole house. The whole house. And I knew it was going to snow. We knew it. Like they told us for days it was going to snow. This is how it goes at my house. This is the inside of my car. Oh. And I'm not proud of this. I'm just saying I've got some faults. This was a breakfast I actually made. My son went to school, my teacher was talking about nutrition and said, you should have lots of colors on your plate. She said, what colors, you know, what are some of the colors your mom makes? And he said, mostly black, sometimes brown. Thanks, buddy. Thanks for that. But listen, here's the deal. I'm good at other things, right? I'm good at other things. I might not be your typical mom or woman even, and as I started learning the word, I started going to this Bible study class, and it was hardcore, okay? It was this hardcore class. I was like, I can't do this stuff. I don't even know how to spell submit. I don't know what spinning, you know, the thing about this, the whole Proverbs 31 just makes me so tired. I don't know how to do any of those things. Purple linen, I don't know what that is. I don't even know where to buy that. So I don't have organizing skills. I told you, my sister Jenny, she's type A. She's got it together. Both my sisters are really organized. I didn't get that gene. I'm good at other things, though, you know? And so I was just beating myself up about how I just didn't measure up to other moms I knew. I could not make cupcakes for the parties, all that stuff. I couldn't measure up, and I was just beating myself up over it. And you all do the same thing. You all do the same thing. You're looking at whatever somebody else is posting on Facebook. They're lying. They copied that picture from Pinterest. You know? We're not in a contest. And so a couple of years ago, I was swimming, okay, really struggling with, what is wrong with me? Like, why can't I just be normal? Why do I just want to watch basketball? My husband called me last year during the NCAA championship from China. Okay, he calls me, I don't even know what time it was, but he calls me, and I haven't talked to him in a few days, but it's during the national championship. And I said, can you call me back in a few minutes? The game is on. Which is not in Proverbs 31 anywhere, I promise. So I'm just beating myself up over it, trying to figure out, okay, do I just need to wear skirts all the time? I don't know. I don't know how to do this right. So I had started swimming. I was having some back problems. So I thought, Savannah swims. I need to get into this. So I go to the swim center in the mornings. And I would go early in the mornings. Nobody was there. And so I would swim this way down. And I don't really even know how to tell you the strokes for this. Savannah could. But so I'd swim this way down. And then I would swim backwards on the way back. So I just kind of had this little system going, and I was a lot faster backwards than I was forward, which is a testimony to the rest of my life. So I'm swimming, and I'm just getting bored. There's no scoreboard, there's no clock. I'm a little competitive, and so I'm just really getting bored with this whole swimming thing. So I'm on the end, I've just swam down, and I'm resting. And I see on either side of me these two gentlemen, elderly gentlemen, who swim up and they touch the side and they turn around. And they're doing like their water therapy, like rehab. Okay, they're just doing their thing. They've got doctor's orders. They're just swimming and taking their time. They're at least 80, okay? Which is wonderful. I hope I can swim when I'm 80. So I'm watching them and I'm resting, and they turn and I think, I can take them. I think I can take them. But it really wouldn't be fair. I don't want to not be fair. So I'm going to let them get halfway. And then I know I can get there. So I push off of that, the side of that pool, like I am in the Olympics. I mean, this is for the gold medal. I am swimming, stroking, swimming as hard as I can, splashing everywhere. I'm exhausting myself. I've never put forth this much ever. And so I'm starting to gain. Like I can see one of them and I'm getting close. and I'm about to pass him, and then I'm about to pass the next one. And so overhead, when you swim backwards, there are these rafters, and you count them, okay, because there's an end to the pool. And normally I'm just, you know, taking my time and counting the rafters, but I'm about to pass them. And so I'm checking how close am I, how close am I, how close am I, and bam, I hit the end of that pool so hard, everybody in the whole building stopped and gasped. The lifeguard is climbing down to save me. I'm in 3 feet of water. The water aerobics group has stopped. They're coming. Please, I'm fine. Please don't come in here and get me. Please don't. I pull myself off the side. I walk over, get my towel, put it over my head. I make the walk of shame back to the locker room. I start showering. I am mortified. I mean, mortified because the men on either side of me just turn and keep going because they don't know they're in a race with me. They didn't even notice me because they're just doing what they're supposed to be doing. And I'm taking a shower and just, I mean, I don't even want to walk out to my car because I'm going to see somebody I know. And it was as if the Lord just spoke to my spirit. You have been looking at other people to try to figure out how to do this life for far too long now. And all I'm asking you to do is just keep your eyes on me and I'll show you what to do. I'll show you what to do. And I don't have to be like everybody else, and neither do you. Because you know what? I'm not the mother of your child, and you're not the mother of mine. And my kids have needs that I'm equipped to meet, and your kids have needs that only you are equipped to meet. Only you, Mama. Your kids were made for you, and you for them. And God knows what He's doing. He knows what He's doing. There are some of you that are raising kids with a whole assortment of special needs and disabilities, and you feel unqualified. I know you do. You're the one. You're the one. You're irreplaceable for that child. They're not looking for somebody else. You're the one. All of you have kids with special gifts and needs, and you're the one. You just keep your eyes on Him, and He'll show you what to do. Don't doubt yourself. Comparison is the second thing you need to let go of. And the third one is fear. All right? Fear. And we fear a lot of things. Okay? Jen mentioned several of them. We want our kids safe and happy, and we don't want to fail, right? We don't want to fail. And there are things that we don't want our kids to be involved in, for good reason, a lot of them. And some of them is just plain old fear. Our heart just races thinking about our kids being in tough situations. And so there are times where I have to overcome fear in the particular calling that God has asked us to do, because we go to some places that are very unsafe. And so there's this particular story that I'm going to show you before I finish, because it happened in West Africa, in Ghana, West Africa. And we came across this group of women sitting in this little circle of homes, huts. And they're sitting there and they're grinding up shea butter, and it's the northern part of Ghana. And it's been dominated by a very oppressive religion, especially for women. They have zero rights. And so this young man, who is a very new follower of Jesus, his name was Jude, he was about 19 years old when this happened. And he said, "Miss Wendy, would you come and talk to these, would you come and share the gospel with these ladies? Because I'm not allowed, because I'm a man. Would you come and tell them the gospel?" And I was like, "Sure, I will." So we go over. And he tells them that we've come from a very long way. And we brought our children on this particular trip because we wanted them to see places in the world. We want them to see the blessings they have, but also the needs in the world. And so they're in the little neighborhood next door with my husband, and I'm with a couple of college guys and Jude. And so I began to share the story that drew me to Jesus, that God created the world and us in fellowship with him, and we had everything we needed. Everything was perfect. And then we stepped away from that. We chose something different from him. And I was showing her this band we have, this bracelet. We were, and it's a gold spot, how we were created in this perfection. Everything was great. We stepped away into darkness, chose our own way. And the next generation stepped a little bit farther, and the next generation stepped a little bit farther, until we ended up with whole nations who didn't know about this Father. And so God, because he is merciful and compassionate and loves us, he so loved us that he sent his son, that anybody who believed in him would not perish but would have eternal life. And this symbol red signified the death that Jesus paid so that we could be free from our sin, so that we could come back to God, so we could bridge that gap and come back to God. And when we began to say this, when I began to explain this part of the story, this man drove up on a bike, and he starts to yell, and the women are sitting there, and their children are back behind, and they're playing. The children are playing and laughing, and they're loud, and they're not even paying attention. The women aren't making eye contact with me. I'm like, this is a waste of time, but whatever. I'll just go through the motions. So Jude continues to translate for me. This man starts yelling, and he pulls out a machete, and he starts waving it over his head, and he starts pointing at us, and I'm like, I don't think he wants us here. I think it's time to go. Jude says, hold on 1 second, Miss Wendy. He walks over, he gets in the man's face, he starts pointing his finger in his face, he starts pointing at me, and they have a little arguing match, and he comes back and he said, okay, you may continue. All righty, we'll just pick up where we left off. So I'm trembling. The boys behind me, I've never heard anybody pray like that before. I mean, they are getting Pentecostal back here. They are going for it, all right? And they're saying, and so I tell the rest of the story, that when we accept that Jesus, that this is what's true, that he was God's son, and that God, in his mercy, sent him as a sacrifice, and that he raised him from the dead, so that when we believe in him, we too can be raised from the dead, and we are cleaned from all that sin and all that darkness and made brand new, that the old is gone and the new has come. And that when we're clean, then we start to grow, and there's this green stripe. We start to grow in our relationship, and God begins to feed our soul and that hungry place in us, and it starts to grow and blossom. And then it says that when we finish that, when we're finished growing, when we're finished changing and becoming like him, that we're returned right back to where we started in the presence of God. And I told them this story, and when I was finished, I said with very little belief, I know that this would be very dangerous for you, and I know that maybe this might be the first time you've ever heard this, but do any of you ladies believe that this is true? Do any of you ladies want to know about following Jesus? And this lady right in front of me, she sat there and she looked up at the man who's still standing there. She looked him dead in the eyes. And she started talking to Jude. And Jude's translating. He says, she says that she saw you earlier in the village, and that she saw that you had your children with you. And I told her the story about Mary, about how Mary had come into this place where these men were, and she had broken the cultural rules, and that Jesus stood up for her. That's who Jesus was. And she said to him, I saw her, and I thought, this lady must be crazy. And then she came over here, and she started telling me why she came this far. And I heard you say, because what Jude said to the man was, you know me, and you know where I live, and you knew me before, and this is true. This story of Jesus is true. And so if you have to kill us, then kill us now, but we need to get back to what we're doing. And I'm so glad he did not tell me that before. And she said, because she has risked this to come here and tell us this, and because you've risked your life, I believe this is true. I believe that this Jesus is true, and I'm going to follow him. And she stood up where she was, and when she stood up, the lady behind her stood up. And by this time, all of the children at the back are frozen to see what their mom, I mean, they're stopped and frozen in place to see what their moms are going to do. And when she stood up, this lady stood up, and then that lady stood up, and five women stood up in front of this man who had threatened them and said, I'm following Jesus, and it's worth the risk. And all of those children, when their moms stood up, they started to cheer and clap. And they started dancing around, and they had seen all that had happened. And listen, ladies, there are things that are scary, and there are risks, and our children are going to have to risk some things, and sometimes we're going to get hurt in doing the things that God calls us to. Our children need to know that our life is based on something more solid than them and more solid than we are. That is safe. That is what safety is, knowing that their lives are rooted in something deep and strong and solid. And our children need that out of us too. We are trying to manage things, work things, take care of things, carry things. And God is saying, I need you to trust me and I'll handle it. And it'll look scary and it'll look like I'm not showing up, but I am. I want to close with this because one of the scary things that we've done, one is write a book telling this story, and that's the scariest thing I've ever done. Ghana, not even close. But putting your whole life out for other people to read, people will say, oh, people I've never met before. Oh, remember when this happened? And that's just you're so exposed. So that was a step of faith. But we also were asked by a group of crisis pregnancy centers in South Carolina if we would come before the state senate to testify on a bill that would ban abortions past 20 weeks in a pregnancy, which is a controversial issue. And we thought about it long and hard, and I wrestled with it because I thought, I don't want our family to get caught up in controversy. I'm a peacemaker. I don't want to get involved in politics. I don't want this to be our family's thing. And we prayed about it, and we thought about it, and we just kept falling upon the scripture, speak up for those that cannot speak for themselves. And so we went before the South Carolina State Senate, a committee of all men. And Savannah and I sat there, and we watched as one by one each witness went in front of them. We thought we were just giving a little two or three minute testimony. They grilled every one of them. Every witness that came forward, they grilled questions. And I'm beginning to shake, and I'm watching Savannah's leg, and it's just jumping, just like this. And I know that I'm about to lose her. Like, she's getting ready to take off. And so I'm praying. I get up. I tell the story about us being in that ultrasound. And I tell the story about how the doctor said that that our marriage was going to fall apart, that we were going to be in financial ruin, all of the things that were going to be wrong, that she was going to be, that it would be inhumane not to end this. And then I introduced my daughter, Savannah. And I want to tell you what she said before those men, but I thought you might like to hear it for yourself. So let me invite my daughter, Savannah, up here. And she's, this is what she said before the Senate, and she's got just a couple of words that she wrote for you. Do you need me to put that? Hold it.
Is it on?
Mm-hmm.
Can y'all hear me? Okay, because that would have been really awkward. Okay. All right, I've never cried in front of a big group except once at the Senate, so if I do, I'm sorry. Okay, but I don't think I will, so okay. It's Psalms 139, 13 through 16. Okay. For you created my inmost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. I praise you because I am fearfully and wonderfully made.
Oh, gosh. You got this.
Your works are wonderful. I know that full well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was made in the secret place. When I was woven together in the depths of the earth, your eyes saw my unformed body. All the days ordained for me were written in your book before one of them came to be. All right.
Hold that, please.
Okay. So on the plane right up here, I knew I was going to be reading that, but my mom asked me if I could write a letter to moms, and I knew that wasn't going to work. So I decided that I would make a little do's and don't list to some extent, because y'all are going to hear a bunch of parent views this weekend. And so, so I thought that if you hear a little bit of a, like, five little do and don't things from the other end, then that would be a little different. Okay, so the first, okay, so I'll just start. Do let them hang out with their friends. Hold on, it gets better. Don't stalk them in your minivan when they go out and get ice cream. Do take funny pictures on Snapchat. Don't let your kids save them.
Amen.
And I would have a picture up there on the screen, but I'm not allowed to do that. Okay. Do encourage your kids when they're learning how to drive. Don't scream, for the love of sweet fancy Moses, when they hit their first line of buggies in the parking lot of Dollar General. Which, you have no idea what that's like. Do watch funny movies with your kids and quote it until the cows come home. Don't pull the Jesus card every time something unholy comes up, because sometimes we know not what to do. And the last one is do hug and don't smother, because we love hugs, but sometimes we like to breathe. So those are just five little things that I wrote down just because that's what I thought of. But, you know, we don't tell y'all this a lot, but we do love you. We won't say it in front of our friends most of the time. After a while, we will. We just have to grow into that. But we appreciate y'all a lot, and y'all do a lot for us. And whether we know it or not, we appreciate that. So I just want to tell you guys, for all the kids you have or are about to have, thank you.
All right.
You're going to stay here with me.
The band is going to come up here in just a few minutes. They're going to close us out with one more song. And as they're coming, I want to tell you this one story, just to kind of set this up, because we're just going to have, just want you to just think about those things. Maybe you're like this, the woman in Ghana who needs to come out of that cave and needs to take that chance on God taking care of things, that you don't have to carry the weight of the world. Maybe this is the night. We were talking at dinner about how sometimes there are seasons where your heart's ready. Sometimes your heart's hard and you feel like you don't need God. Maybe you're in a place where it's time and you're ready. And we don't want to miss that. We don't want you to miss that. And we love things like this because you remember. You remember the moment. And you don't let it slide. And I want to close with a story because this is what it's like. My husband left and went to China a few years ago and the kids were little, and I was just really angry. I didn't want to do this anymore. He's traveling and I'm at home, and this couldn't be what the plan was. This couldn't be what God had in store for us. And so I'm mad at him, I'm mad at everybody else, and I'm at home one night and he's gone. I've made him miserable before he went. And kids are in bed, and my mom has sent me this email, because moms they forward emails. And so she sent me this story, and it was about this little girl named Jenny. And Jenny was in the store with her mom, okay, just like our kids have been a million times. And we're at the checkout line, she sees this little box of pearls, okay, in a little foil box. And Jenny wants that box of pearls. She's five. She wants the box of pearls. Begs her mom for it. Mom says, no, you have to save up birthday money. You can come back later. So she does. She saves her money. She buys that box of pearls, and she wears them everywhere. She wears them everywhere, to the neighbors, to her little softball league. She wears them everywhere, even in the shower, and it makes her neck green, but she's wearing the pearls. And her daddy comes in one night, and he says, Jenny, will you give me something? She says, sure, Daddy, anything. He says, will you give me your pearls? She says, Daddy, not my pearls. You can have my little pony or Barbie, but not my pearls. Please, Daddy, don't take my pearls. He says, okay, baby, I love you anyway. Next night he comes in, same thing. Please don't take my pearls, Daddy. You can take anything else, but not my pearls. Night after night he comes in. And one night he comes in, and Jenny's sitting on her bed, and her little chin is just quivering. And he says, honey, what's the matter? And she said, here, Daddy. You asked me if I love you, and I said yes. And I told you I wouldn't give you my pearls. But I do love you, and I'm going to give you my pearls. And she cried as she let go of them. And when she let go of those pearls, her daddy reached into his pocket, and he pulled out this box, this velvet box, with real pearls in it. And I read that story, and I cried, and I cried, and I cried, because I realized I'd had this plan for my life, and I had things that I wanted, and I had these dreams, and that God's ways were higher, and that he knew what he was doing. And if it didn't look like what I thought it was going to look like, then he had a plan, and I just couldn't see it yet. And so I went the next morning to church. My husband was flying back to China. And I went at the end of the service, I went to the altar and I took a set of pearls that I'd been given on my wedding day. And I knelt down and I laid them on that altar. And I said, here I am again, God. And I told you I'll give you everything. And so here it is again. And so whatever you need to do with our family, if this is the way it's gotta be, then just teach me. But I'm gonna let go one more time. And I got up, I went home. My husband came home that night. And he always gets little gifts for the kids. And so he's pulling out t-shirts and little toys and things. And he said, honey, I feel so bad about this, but I just didn't have time to shop. And I know you already have this. And he pulled out this little bag with a genuine set of Asian pearls. And I knew that God had shown up and he was going to keep showing up for us, and that things are hard. And when that muscle is forming that pearl, that piece of sand in there, and forming that pearl, it's hard and it's dark in there, but it's becoming something beautiful. And so I just want to ask you, we're gonna stand and sing in just a few minutes, but I just want to ask you first, like this woman in Ghana, is there anybody here who would have the courage to say, I don't know if I've ever done this before, but just to say, I know this is the time. I know this is the time. And that Jesus is calling me out of the grave. And then I believe he's true. And I've never been willing to trust him before, but I'm ready. if that is you, the ladies from Passion for Moms are going to be around this room. You find them because you're going to need somebody to come alongside you. And don't let this moment pass you by. You need somebody to help hold you up and walk through, because coming out of the grave is not the hardest part. It's staying out of the grave. And then there are those of you who maybe you already have a relationship with Jesus, but it's been hard lately, and it's been shallow lately. And you just need a fresh fire. And you know that there are things that he's asking you to let go of, maybe to give up, but certainly to trust him with. And this is the time. And you know what it is. I don't have any idea what it is. But you know. And so during this song of worship, I just want to ask you to give that to God. Just to lift your hands and let go of the thing, whatever it is, and trust him. He's so good. He's so good.